So good morning and thank you for being here. My name is Francisco Cardenas and I'm finishing my principal practicum at the University of Texas, Rio Grande Valley, TRGV. And this is observation number 3, which is campus improvement plan, or campus improvement project. So we're improving literacy skills for the 2019-2020 school year. It's a beautiful picture of our school. Yesterday. All right, so here are the principal standards. This is what I'm required to fulfill when I'm doing my role as a principal. So standard number 1, which is knowledge and skills. The effective instructional leader prioritizes instruction instead of achievement by developing and sharing a clear definition of high quality instruction on best practices from research. We implement a rigorous curriculum aligned with Texas state standards. In schools led by effective instructional leaders, data are used to determine instructional decisions and monitor progress, and then also B, the indicators. Effective instructional practices. The principal develops high-quality instructional practices among teachers that improve student learning. And then finally, the last one, the principal monitors multiple forms of student data to inform instructional and intervention decisions. To close the achievement gap. So overall, that's what we're going to try to do today. We're going to look at data. We're going to identify some of our low-performing teams, and then we're going to see how our program could possibly increase student performance. So here is phase 1. For phase 1, what we did is we collected information, data from previous scores. So here is our campus demographics from last year. Last year, we had 2,046 students on campus. Out of those students, 90% of our population is economically disadvantaged. That number is about the same. If anything, we might have a few more students this year, or it's close to that. Our English language learners, we have 25% of them on campus, which is a big portion of our campus. Our diverse learners, we have 9%, and then our at-risk population is 70%. So all of these groups, all of these demographics can somehow, you know, there's research that kind of suggests that we have low scores due to having a high number of economically disadvantaged students. Our ELL students struggle with the exam, so that's one of the other reasons. So we have a high number of EL students. And then, of course, our diverse learners and our at-risk population is also kind of high. So here are our scores from the past 2 years, 2018 and 2019, for STAR EOC English 1. So these are the students who met the approaches level. We didn't go into meets or masters, but just the approaches. So out of all students in 2018, we went from 50% to 2019, 58. So that was a good increase right there. Our special ed department, or our diverse learners, went from 19% to 27. So also a large increase. And then our eco disadvantage from 48% to 56%. And our EL students also saw a jump from 38 to 47. So overall, our English 1 students did great. So whatever differentiating strategies we're doing in class are working. We're doing good things with our kids. So that's a positive thing, positive note. But if we compare ourselves to the states, if you notice the first column right here, this is the state average. This is our campus, and then this is the district. So for the last one, we take an average of us and our sister school, and then we come up with that grade. So as you can see, compared to the states, our students are still performing subpar. In 2019, although we saw increases in all of our categories, we are still a little bit below. So we're at 58, we're at 53. So Donna High students are scoring below state average. That is a fact. Okay. So regardless of the jumps that we've had, we're still, you know, we're still below. And then here are English 2 scores. So this is, you know, this is us right here. We're all English 2 teachers. In 2018, we had 57% students reach or get to the meet, I mean to the approach level. And in 2019, last year, we jumped all the way to 65. So that was a good increase, a good jump right there. Our special ed also saw an increase from 27 to 31. But our economically disadvantaged overall went from a 57 to a 53%. So we saw a drop here in this area. And then our EL students, they stayed at 40%. By the way, 40 is really high for EL students, especially when we compare just the EL to the rest of the states. Our schools are doing an amazing job. We actually fell for English 2 a little bit below our sister school. So they scored a little bit higher than we did when it comes to the EL population. So again, you know, some of the strategies that we're doing, that they're doing, we need to continue to do. Here is a look at all our students and how we again compare to the state. So here's the state in yellow. Here's Donna High. And then, of course, here is Donna North. Okay, so again, in EL, the EL students perform higher than our EL students. But overall, our students were a little bit higher, at 57, they scored lower. So we averaged out to a 51. And then here's a look at just our other subjects. Notice that our other subjects are kicking butt for the most part. Our algebra scores from last year, they scored at a 79, but we averaged out to an 80. So our, you know, down north scored a little bit higher when it comes to math. And then we're right below the state also. For biology, we had the exact same score. We averaged out to an 81, and that's what our sister school also had, 81. And again, we're right below the state average, which is this one in yellow. And then for history, we outperformed the states and our sister school at a 95%. Keep in mind, though, that despite these high scores, only biology and ELA received the distinction when it comes to the accountability ratings. Do you guys know why U.S. history, having such a high score, did not get that star? Any ideas?
Wasn't it for improvement?
Improvement was one area.
Reaching master's mean semester.
Yes, that is mainly why they don't have enough students scoring high. So we have a lot of students, 95, almost all students passing, reaching the approaches, but we have fewer getting to meets, and then even less getting to that master's. And for them, master's at 89%. So that's what their kids need to get. Yeah, 89. So, again, the program we're going to be discussing today, if applied to the entire campus, I think it could benefit all of us. So even though our scores are high here, there's still room for improvements. All right, so our Donna High Campus Improvement Plan from last year, based on these scores, we came up with the following, or the school came up with the following. Donna High School will create an inviting educational climate that enhances learning and academic performance for all students so that they may excel in all areas of education and meet state and federal passing standards. So that's our ultimate goal. Overall, we have 5 goals, but these are the ones that were linked directly to instruction and to our scores. So I highlighted the actual goal. It says the campus will implement literacy strategies that will result in more students reading on or above grade level. And that's, you know, exactly what we're gonna attempt to do with the reading program. And then on this one, the beginning is the same, but then we get to the highlighted part. It says the percentage of students who achieve meets and or master's performance level on STAR exam will increase. So we're looking to increase those students. We want to maintain our STAR that we received last year. And we got it for many reasons, right? But one of those is to make sure that we have a high level
morning, faculty,
of master's students.
And welcome back to the Halls of Donna High School. We want to remind you that today we do have end of course STAR testing, retesting for some students. We want to inform students that during the day, the bells will be turned off. And if you have displaced classes, you have classes in the 120 wing, you will be going to the gym. Attendance is being taken, so students, you will need to sign in on the teacher's roster. Students that are not on the roster will be sent back to their classes or to the front office.
this information tell us? Well, our need statement, that indicates that our student performance is below state average on ELC assessments. So we will implement a literacy program to try to close those gaps. Okay, so phase two, that was phase one, we gathered the information. Phase two is we'll try to look for a solution. So here are the benefits, and you guys are English teachers, so you already know these benefits. But the benefits of reading. When we read, we help reduce stress. We can distract you, allowing you to relax. It increases vocabulary, which we know our students can benefit from. It improves memory and focus, because reading stimulates the brain. It enhances your imagination. You attain stronger analytical thinking skills. Also strengthens your writing abilities. We know there's a correlation, a connection directly from reading to writing. The better a student reads, more than likely they will write better. So we want to expose our students to published, well-written works because they have a noted effect on one's own writing. And then reading is contagious, so it can help create a better learning environment. And we'll talk about that in a little bit. I'll give you some examples of what's worked in my classes before. And then, of course, this last one, it can make you more empathetic. Books take us out of our own environment, and they show us the realities of others out there. Prior to this, we had also talked about conversations that we've had with our students, and we ask them, some of them sometimes make comments about novel reading, and they're like, well, sir, the last time I read a novel was in elementary, or in sixth grade kind of thing. So that is why Mr. Paticati had kind of suggested the idea of what we need them, to get to read. So that's where the idea came from. So here are the benefits of reading. It says vocabulary exposure increases with daily reading time. So a typical first grader reads about 15 minutes a day. At this pace, she's on track to encounter 5.7 million words by the end of the grade, by the end of 12th grade. If reading time increases to 30 minutes or more, the student will read on average of 13.7 million words by the end of grade 12. Okay, so that's a pretty big number. Now, our kids are already, 9th and 10th graders. So on average, kids who read less than 15 minutes a day are likely to encounter only 1.5 million words during the course of their schooling. So what does that tell us? That a student who reads 1.5 million words would learn only 1,500 new vocabulary words from reading, while a student who reads 13.7 million words would learn 13,700 new vocabulary terms. So, for example, this novel right here, Tears of a Tiger, it's about a 7th or 8th grade reading level, but the interest is considered 9th through 12th. This book has 26,000 words. So just reading this is already, kind of building that vocabulary for our students. All right, so drop reading and read. What is it? Frequent high-quality reading practice may help your children compensate for and even overcome the challenges of being socially or economically disadvantaged, which we have a high percentage of. So reading practice matters for kids from all walks of life. So that is why we want to implement this. What is DEAR? Drop reading and read time, better known as DEAR time, is a time regularly set aside in the classroom for both students and their teachers to drop everything and read. DEAR is not intended to be a substitute for other instruction. It supplements the regular reading program by encouraging independent reading, but it does not replace guided reading. So whatever lessons we're, differentiation strategies we're doing in classroom already, we need to continue doing those. This would be just on the side. And DEAR is an important part of the daily, weekly classroom schedule. So when it becomes a routine, the kids enjoy it and they want to do it and they will read more, hopefully. All right, so here are the different DEAR scenarios. Now there's when you do a little bit of research on DEAR, you see that it's an old program. It's been established for a long time. The main purpose of drop everything and read is to practice sustained silent reading. lets the students choose their own novel, which of course usually it's approved by the teacher. There's little to no monitoring, so the kids are just reading for pleasure, and we're you know, assuming that they are as a teacher, right? There's few discussions afterwards. There's little to no collaboration, and the reading is for pleasure, so that's one of the pluses. The more they read, the better readers and writers they will become. Now, we have to modify that because of the type of students that we have. So, ideally in our classroom, I don't think that if we start today, we can get our students to silent read for 20 minutes. So we need to engage them first. So here are some modifications that we can do for our students when we implement the reading program. So first, we have to build that capacity. So the guided reading, it has to be there from the beginning. Class sets of novels, we're going to start with everybody in the classroom is reading the same novel. That way the teacher can have feedback, and we can also have conversations about it, discussions, and the students get to analyze and share their ideas. So we need to make sure that we select high-interest novels to engage the students, provide guided, modeled reading initially, and then little by little we wean them off so that at the end, you know, they can be doing that sustained silent reading. But first we have to build the capacity. Again, once we build the capacity, then we can guide them towards the SSR. So that is what the suggestion is. And at the end, they both have the same outcome. The more they read, the better readers and writers they will become. One of the ways that we can do it at the beginning of the school year, or at the beginning of the second semester, is by implementing literature circles. Has anybody heard of literature circles or practiced them in the past? I know for me it's been a few years, but thinking back, it's something that really worked for my students. However, we did away with novel reading in the classroom, and we concentrated more on the TEKS, and it was, you know, so we kind of did away with that. But here's what literature circles are. It is small groups of students who gather together to discuss a piece of literature in depth. The discussion is guided by a student response to what they have read. They may hear, or you, as you walk around, the teacher may hear about events, about characters in the book, about author's craft, hopefully, right? Applause, you know, or personal experiences related to the story. So we want the students to interact with the text, make connections, and have fun reading the text. They provide a way for students to engage in critical thinking and reflection as they read, discuss, and respond to the books. And there's collaboration. It is the heart of the approach, and every student has a role which promotes accountability. So if we're worried sometimes, we have that student in our groups who, you know, maybe wait to the end and just sign their name on the project and get away with not doing anything. Well, literature circles, again, gives everybody accountability because everybody has a role. And finally, at the end, literature circles guide students to deeper understanding of what they read through structured discussion and extended written and artistic response. So if you look at the folders that I gave you guys, I included about three different sets of literature roles that you can use for these literature circles. So the way it works is, let's say we're doing, you can do it with guided reading, and you could also do it with group reading. So today we're reading from pages 1 through 10, because we're doing it, we have a short amount of time, right? So as you're doing this, we can look at the first set. This one right here. The teacher comes around and assigns, and usually for me it worked in the past where I would just assign them randomly. Right? I would pass them out the way that I printed them out, I would pass them out to the students. You'll notice with time that some students prefer to do other activities than other. So for example, the first one is the word master. So let's say Dulce is the word master today. We're all reading pages 1 through 10, and as we read, Dulce's job is to locate at least 5 vocabulary words. Right? And then at the end, she'll have a little bit of time to find the definitions. And when we come together and talk about it at the end, she's going to share her findings. The questioner. Ms. Gama's got the questionnaire. So her job, as we read, is to write down a few questions that she had about the reading. What are you wondering about? Is there anything you didn't understand? Did you wonder what particular word meant or how things fit together? Any questions that arise as we're reading, then that would be her job to jot them down. Mr. Fatikati received the illustrator, because he's a really good artist, a really good drawer. So his job is to, it says, good readers make pictures in their minds as they read. Your job is to draw a picture related to today's reading. It can be any picture, anything that stood out as we read, he will recreate that scene. The literary luminary, this one right here is kind of like highlighting important parts of the text. So your job is to locate, identify a few special selections or quotations in the text for your group to discuss. So at the top, you write the page number of the paragraph, where you got it, you write down the quotes, the little paragraph, and then in the bottom, you tell us why you chose it. So it's very important for this one to tell the student to analyze it. Don't just summarize what you copied down, but tell us why you thought that was important. And then finally, the last one is the connector. Okay, so the student is in charge of making two connections. From pages 1 through 10, anything that you thought of, create two connections, and they can be, of course, text-to-text, text-to-self, or text-to-word. So, once you've allotted the students, you've read in class, maybe you can have a whole classroom discussion, but then let the kids break up into their own groups, and they need to share this information with themselves, provide feedback to themselves, things like that. And you'll be, at first, they're a little bit shy, but when the book is really interesting, the conversations start coming out, and you'll be surprised. The kind of talk that's happening, communication that's happening between the students. So this is just one set, and then I gave you two more that have different roles. And this is just one easy way for the teacher to monitor that there's comprehension, that the students are engaged with the reading. So if you have a chance later, look at the other sets and use the ones that you feel would work better for your students. So here are, we talked about 5 rows in the first set that I covered, but here are different rows that you can give your students. The summarizer, for some reason it's not a very popular one, but the summarizer is one of them. The travel tracker, the conflict connector. You're covering conflict in class, that would be, you know, one good role to give one of the students. Character people tracker, when we're doing character analysis, there it is. The wordsmith, which is similar to the word wizard, the connector, the illustrator, the researcher, the literary reactor, and the theme tracker. So notice how they call it different things, but overall, again, these are different roles that you can create for the kids in your class. So, literature circles is what I would recommend that you use at the beginning. It is a tool, like I said, that I've used in the past, and it really worked. And at first, there's a lot of modeling because you have to tell the student exactly what the expectation is. But once you do that, the rest is very low prep because the students already understand what their job is. And most importantly, if they're really into the reading, they want to do it. They want to get into the reading. They want to have those discussions. And that's what we want to create. That's what we're aiming for. Once we get a little bit further, let's say after we read our first novel maybe, we can introduce the novel folders. And we can use, some of you guys have done some of these in the past. I know Dulce has shared something similar, but for a short story, right? Yeah, so there's like different varieties that you can do. Here's one that I use for the novel that precedes this one, which is Forged by Fire. And basically what we do is we give the kids a folder. And there's a lot more sustained sighted reading when we do this type of thing. And what the kids do is, on the inside, we break it down by chapters. And then the kids, let's say today we're reading chapters 1 and 2. So for chapter 1, I need you to give me a summary. For chapter 2, I want you to give me highlights of the most important part, you know, main idea kind of thing. And it's very minimal writing, but you can track characters, you can talk about theme, you can track vocabulary. And they kind of take ownership in this, and yeah, as you can see, they decorate. Most of the kids take a little pride in decorating their folders. In the back, you use the rest of the chapters. another example. This kid did an awesome job, but they left my class. So. But I wanted to show you the artwork. And then here's another one. This kid was very reluctant to do anything in class, but when it came to reading, he did some, and I remember he enjoyed, reading the book. And again, novel folders is something that we can do. So when we get there, we can get together, come up with ideas. If you guys have any ideas, please share them with us as well. So what's the benefit of a novel folder? Well, it's a graphic organizer. It works well with guided reading. It works well with sustained reading also, and is recommended for maybe novel 2, and if we get to a novel 3, that would be something ideal. It's easy to keep track of them. If you want to give the students a grade, you have that option because you can see, the evidence when you open the folders. Okay, so let me just go over the timeline. I had to break down this in phases. So phase one is what we did at the beginning. We had to analyze the data. We had to analyze the end of course for the last 2 years. We discussed the results with the ELA department and the committee members, well, some of the ELA department. We analyzed data to determine achievement gaps, and then we brainstormed possible ways that we could improve literacy in our classrooms. And then we researched programs, and we selected one that we could use campus-wide, which is the Drop Everything and Read program. We set goals for semester 2, and we plan to kickoff date is January 8th. So when we come back on the 6th, we have instructional planning day. Then the 7th is our first day, so the following day, if it falls on our calendar, and if we see those kids, we will begin that day. For phase two, we reviewed data with the departments. We introduced the reading program, which you did right now. We meet with the ELA department and discuss results with teachers, including data. So we will reconvene and we will talk about how it's going in our classrooms, if we have any suggestions, if we have any adoption of new novels. Some of you guys are, you guys are readers, so anything that you suggest that you feel the students would love reading, then by all means, we want those suggestions. We discuss timelines and schedule for the program during student success. This will happen during student success. And then we're going to provide research-based interventions and resources. So here's what our schedule would look like for English 2. So on, let's say, Monday, this is a maroon week. So on Monday, it's maroon, Tuesday, gold, etc. Student success, we're going to use student success period to do the reading. We do have to go through our announcements. So right at 10, we'd have to break, make sure that we show the kids our announcements from 10 to 10:05, and then we'd get into our reading. So we are all off on maroon days. So on gold days, this is what our schedule would look like. So we'd be implementing the reading program from 10:06 to 10:25 when we release the kids. So one day I would suggest that all we do is read, kind of have a brief discussion before they leave, read as much as we can. And then on Thursday, we would allow the kids a little bit of time to do their literature circles, to complete their sheet if they haven't yet, and then to have those conversations and discussions. The discussions can be as a classroom, or they can be in your groups. The role of the teacher is just to walk around and kind of make sure that, that the kids are having those conversations. And that's what our schedule would look like. So in 1 week, we'd only read twice, but then on even weeks, we get a chance to read Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays. All right, so that's what our schedule looks like. This will be something that we will continuously monitor. So again, like I said, we will reconvene. We will make sure that we have, if it's not working, then we need to make sure that we make some changes. So committee members will routinely check to see that the program is being implemented with fidelity. A list of non-compliant teachers will be submitted to the principal. I know it sounds almost like a threat, but that's what they want us to do. The committee members will meet with their departments every 4 weeks to discuss the reading program and its progress. So once you get information from your teachers and your department, then you bring it to the committee. The committee will modify the program and create new interventions if needed. The committee will also select and deliver other novels, titles, to teachers around the campus, provide necessary professional development for teachers. That may include further training and modeling of desired interactions. So if they need me to go to the history department and model an activity, then that's something that, I have signed up for and I'm excited about. And the committee will meet again in May to analyze the results of our Story OC and see if there was any gains, particularly in the reading comprehension part of the exam, which is where students, our students at least, struggle the most. And we want to see, you know, we want to see the students use, if the topic allows itself, maybe use those help examples from the novels that we've read in class. Here is a list of the committee members. So we have Dr. Castillo as our principal. I will be heading the committee. Ms. Kilby, our school librarian. Mr. Paticati, the lay department head. Sergio Garza, this one is subject to change. Rolando Vasquez, the math department head. Ms. Reina Chavez, the special ed department. Mr. Solis, he's the level lead, but he'll be in the committee also. And then Ms. Juanita Martinez will be in charge of arts, of fine arts. She's the fine arts lead. Ms. Cynthia Viesca, the physical education department. Remember that we wanted somebody from every genre, from every subject, because it's something that we want to do school-wide again. All right, so are there any questions? Yes, sir.
Is it assumed or appropriate to think about if they're struggling readers that we would incorporate some guided reading into it?
Absolutely, yes. I think you could sit in with your groups and maybe read yourself, you know, read with them. If you have to pull the student out and do one-to-one instruction, that would be appropriate. In fact, I would recommend that, especially with our struggling readers, with our ESOL students. That's something that, would work best.
You mentioned that this this was going to be implemented campus-wide, right?
Yes.
And would any reading would be selected by the committee?
Well, the reading would be selected by the committee. We would mainly work off of recommendations from our ELA department. I'm not saying that the ELA department is the guru when it comes to reading novels, but we've read them in class, so we know like what actually works with our students. Yeah, if we could tie it into a novel that could fit into other subject areas, then that would be great. But that's not necessarily the purpose of drop everything and read. We want to read fiction. We want to read nonfiction. We want, you know, the kids to read for fun. We don't want them to see this as an assignment, but rather something that they look forward to doing every other day when you see them. So yes, novels, again, high interest. We would take the recommendation of the teachers for that. Sorry, your questions.
So the history and the sciences, they'll be doing a different type of reading? Or?
We would like for like a whole campus to do the same novel at once, but we don't have the resources. So we could alternate books. Let's say we begin as an English department with Tears of a Tiger, then they can begin with Forged by Fire. I read them in that order, it doesn't really need to be. And then at the end of the 6 weeks period, then we can interchange and we can you know, share notes, things like that, and see what works.
So, and when will the students choose their own novel? Because, I mean, the first novel will be guided instruction, literacy circles. Second novel will be something like this. Same novel, all the kids will be reading the same novel. So by the third novel,
so
they implement their own?
By the third novel, they can kind of select their own. I think that would be appropriate. Now remember that we're starting halfway through the year. So we like it and it works for our students. The next year, we can start off with one book, and then the rest of the year it could be, you know, the students choosing their own.
At the refresher.
Their own book, yeah.
And then maybe for the freshmen to start the reading before.
Yep, absolutely. So that would be, that's our goal eventually, to get the kids. select novel that interests them. All right, well, again, I want to thank you guys for